part of growing up, and that carried over into my adult.
Too Fast. The Life and Times of Keith Whitley. Tonight, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. Part of TNN Profiles.
Behind the voice was a private pain that would tragically end his life just as he reached the top. The Life and Times of Keith Whitley, next on TNN.
The smile on your face lets me know that you need me. There's a truth in your eyes saying you'll never leave me. The touch of your hand says you'll catch me.
He had one of the purest voices in country music, a voice that dazzled and influenced a generation.
Yeah, you say it best when you say nothing at all.
There are just those certain people that come around occasionally in a lifetime that affect you when they sing. And like Streisand, you know, and Frank Sinatra, and those kind of people. Keith, to me, is in that kind of category.
Everybody from Garth Brooks, Tim McGraw, Alan Jackson, I think they were just people that as he went by listened to his music and said, you know, that's exactly who I want to be like.
Keith Whitley's singing was infused with emotion, and for good reason. Throughout his short life, Keith battled personal demons that he could never quite control. And by the age of 34, he was gone, just as he reached the stardom he'd sought for so long.
He was such a gifted talent, but frail at the same time. Greatness and sadness, kind of all at once. I think he would have been considered one of the greatest country music singers of all time. Still is in my book, if not the.
When you say nothing at all.
The Keith Whitley story began deep in bluegrass country, the Appalachian Mountains of eastern Kentucky. Keith was born here in the small town of Sandy Hook, and he didn't take long to start singing.
Keith was a colicky baby, and he cried at night. And it was always my job to get up and rock. But as he got older, if we sang to him, he would take his little hand and put it up to our mouth, and then he would try to hum. So, yes, he came into the world singing, is what I said.
Keith was immersed in country music from the time he was born. His parents, Elmer and Faye, had a fine record collection and were musicians themselves.
Our mother played piano, organ, and guitar, a little bit of banjo. Our father played harmonica, and my mother's father, my grandfather, played five-string banjo, and he taught me to play the banjo, and which Keith played some banjo too. But actually, my mother was the one that really got us started on guitar.
He'd just say, "I want you to show me this little bit on this song," or that he loved Lefty Frizzell, George Jones, anything of theirs. So he could just hear it one time and pick it up, start playing it.
Keith began his public singing career at the age of 4, entering a local talent contest.
And he won it. He sung Marty Robbins' Big Iron. And he had on a black cowboy outfit. And they asked him, "Will you do another song for us?" He just unbuckled his gun belts and let them fall to the floor and started out on them, did I'm a Wondering Soul.
At the age of 8, he was singing on local radio.
We have a wee little guest here we want to bring in. Keith Whitley.
The news is out. All over town.
never talked about anything else. Singing was all he ever wanted to do. And I said to him once, when he was in high school, I said, "Don't you think when you finish high school that you ought to take a course in something else?" And he looked at me real hurt, and he said, "Mom, I don't plan to ever do anything but sing."
But singing wasn't young Keith's only passion. His love of motorbikes, a lifelong affair, was evident early.
He always had his bike. He had a motorcycle, a trail bike, when he got old enough. And he had little pedal cars and things he could do. He rode up and down the driveway here.
After his early success, Keith couldn't wait to get on stage. And he talked his older brother into letting him join his high school rock and roll band.
Of course, he was the youngest member, but he sang lead. He was a better singer than any of us. And then I got back into bluegrass real good, real heavy into bluegrass, and got Keith into that.
It was at a bluegrass convention in Kentucky in 1969 that Keith met another promising 15-year-old musician by the name of Ricky Skaggs.
And they just hit it off, and they sang together. And when he come home, he told me, he said, I've met a guy that I think I'd like to play music with.
We invited Ricky over the next weekend to sit in on our radio show, which we had going here. We'd tape it on Wednesday nights, and it was aired on Saturday and Sunday at a little station out of West Liberty, Kentucky. And Ricky came over and just started from there.
Hey, friends, we'd like to say another great big howdy to you and welcome once again to the Mountain Rule Telephone Show. My name's Keith Whitley, and as you know, all the boys that you'll be listening to, down the road here from me, there's an old hollow tree where you lay down a dollar or two.
We used to play in an old place in West Liberty, Kentucky, where they had an outdoor drive-in theater, and we'd get up on the roof and play, and if the crowd liked it, they'd all honk their horns. They could hear us through the PA set, you know.
It wasn't long before Keith and Ricky caught the eye of bluegrass legend Ralph Stanley. It was a break that would set them both on the path to stardom. The Life and Times of Keith Whitley returns in a moment on TNN.